Hello, I'm Arthur Beam. In this mind-blowing episode, the story of the Sabbath will show how the Protestant debate over the Sabbath helped overthrow the ancient way of worshiping, leading to modern church services, as well as helping to bring in the golden age of capitalism. If you are interested in the Sabbath, you will want to understand why the Sabbath was such a controversial subject. So controversial, in fact, that more books and pamphlets were published debating the Sabbath than all other topics. This sudden Sabbatarianism culminated in the 17th century, when newly liberated and Sola Scriptura believing Protestants read the Fourth Commandment and wondered if Christians were keeping the Sabbath correctly. So, this is where the episode must begin. As the 17th century commenced, British East India Company and the Dutch East India Company made their first voyage across several oceans to trade with India, bringing the golden age of capitalism. British separatists fled to the Netherlands for both religious and economic freedom. This group would later immigrate to the U.S. following the Pilgrims. In the meantime, catastrophic wars broke out in Europe, killing millions. Many of the casualties of war were those who died of starvation, causing a massive refugee crisis. Military fatigue became so common that soldiers banded together and wandered across Europe, looting homes for food, raping, and killing. This population decrease contributed to reports of wild animals invading and taking over entire towns, devouring the domesticated animals, as well as terrorizing people. Stories of cannibalism, werewolves, and vampires unnerved even the most faithful Christians. Food prices skyrocketed. Inflation confused the middle class because the riches of the New World were pouring into Europe. This created a few who became incredibly wealthy and at the same time impoverished most. It seemed everything collapsed. The church, the government, and the social systems the people had relied on. A Spanish writer lamented that every nation was turned upside down, and even the most scholarly suspected that the world was approaching its end. Who had time to think of the Sabbath? And yet, in 1582, a few decades earlier, in the little town of Dedham, England, a group of Protestant pastors met secretly. They anxiously looked at the world and its increasing corruption and volatility and decided that Christians needed a Sabbath. Perhaps if the church began to take their rest day more seriously, God's wrath would be appeased. And that sentiment would grow into a new war of its own. The 17th century Sabbath Wars. We know today how natural it is for people to read Scripture and disagree on its interpretation. But the early reformers and their followers were shocked at this. When Protestants read the Old Testament, specifically the Ten Commandments, many wondered why Christians didn't keep the Sabbath strictly as God had commanded Israel. Did God mean for Christians to rest exclusively on the seventh day after a literal six-day working week? Where was the biblical basis for keeping the first day holy?
I'll leave a night and day to be a pilgrim.
Protestants came to radical disagreements on the interpretation of the Fourth Commandment. The Sabbath question particularly plagued a new sect of Christianity, the Puritans. As Americans, when we think of Puritans, the story of Thanksgiving comes to mind. Men in broad-brimmed hats, breeches and stockings, a doublet with a large collar trimmed with lace, yet. Few of us think of Puritans originating in Britain, but they did. It was shortly after the Reformation that many Protestants did not think the Church of England went far enough in breaking with Rome. King Henry VIII, as head of the church, didn't want to stop being Catholic. He just wanted authority over the Pope. Therefore, the Church of England looked very much like Catholicism. England followed the Catholic liturgical year with its mass, or church services, centered around the Eucharist. It followed Rome's sacraments and saints' days, lace and incense. Indeed, not long before this time, the country had been Catholic. Loyal Englishmen who desired the Church of England to behave more Protestant became known as the Puritans. Puritans asked themselves, is the king really the legitimate head of the church? Do the bishops have legitimate authority? They advocated for the church to purify itself from papist errors. Puritans were not a monolith. They had a wide spectrum of theological and political goals. Methods of purging Catholicism from culture and worship differed from sect to sect. When Catholic Mary took the English throne, some Puritans fled to Switzerland and had encountered little theocracies run by French Calvinists. Later, when Protestants reclaimed the English throne, these British Puritans returned, bringing with them romantic notions of a state politic based on sola scriptura, sola fide, and simple worship. All those living in the Calvinist cities were expected to be the elect, and each person was expected to attain a universal holiness. This more radical sect of Puritans was called Separatists. They were different from the English Puritans, who were quickly becoming a large minority in England. The original Puritans had not rejected the idea of a state church, they just wanted to purify it. The Separatists wanted to jettison anything that resembled Rome. They were ready to transform England's church into Calvinistic, autonomous local congregations with new theology that included adult baptism, sacramentarianism, sanctification, and socialism's community of goods. Their worship services were radically transformed. There were to be no catechisms, no sacraments, no rites, nor rituals. Sermons replaced the Lord's Supper as the focal point of worship. Some went so far as to remove even music. These Separatists were armed with political fire and a distrust of church hierarchy. Some of them had a new devotion to strict Sunday Sabbatarianism with political overtones. The king and England's church hierarchy treated these provocative and contentious Separatists as traitors. They deserted their faith and their king. As enemies of the established order, this was treason, punishable by jail or death. King James I, of the biblical translation, wanted church unity, so he not only persecuted Catholics, but Puritans, causing them to flee once again, but this time to the Netherlands. In Holland, the little band of 100 Separatists entered into the empire during its golden age. It was the most powerful and international spot in the world, with many varieties of merchants and artisans and bankers lending them capital. The Netherlands kept wealth flowing in and out of its many ports. Ashkenazi and Sephardic Jews, Anabaptists, Reformed, and Calvinists were among those who contributed to the cosmopolitan feel. At first, the Separatists enjoyed the freedom to worship as they wished, but after a decade, they worried about the corrupting influence of Holland's liberalism. Some of these Separatists wrote that they could no longer abide the Sabbath profanation in the Netherlands. Their children were being drawn away from their faith into the temptations of secularism. They found that tolerance ended up in corruption. Time to leave. English merchants were financing settlement in the New World. There, the separatists hoped they could do the work of establishing a Christian nation and evangelizing the natives, bringing the kingdom of God to all the world. So they hopped on the Mayflower for a different kind of liberty. Their version of the Christian liberty they would establish on the continent. The Puritans were solidly from the working class. They moved the economic machine with their trading, their agriculture and artisan industry. Puritans were anything but idle. And they read their Bibles with the same clarity and economy. The Sabbath commandment was clear. There was to be 6 days before you could take a rest. Many of the Puritans, especially the Calvinist separatists, took this part of the commandment with literal precision. Christians must work for 6 days. They looked around at all the frequent saints' days, which had become holidays in England. Almost a third of the year, they complained, was spent in idle amusements. Puritans thought, surely we could do without all the saints' days and Sundays filled with godless amusements and sports. And Puritans didn't believe in honoring anyone but God, so why celebrate the saints' days? They wondered why the nobles and clergy would stifle their economic freedom with all these unproductive days. God had given the opportunity for economic success, since many of the best merchants in Puritan industry had already fled to the Netherlands, leaving a vacancy they wanted to fill. Capitalistic Holland was attaining world supremacy in banking and industry. This was an opportunity for England, as the New Jerusalem, to attain world supremacy for God. The church and state needed to stay out of their way. Puritans lobbied for only 1 day a week to rest, which gave them only 1 day a week for worship. So Puritans began a crusade against saints' days. Businesses loved the idea, more profit, if their employees worked more days of the year. So Parliament abolished holy days in 1647, declaring instead the substitute of a secular federal holiday, the second Tuesday of each month. Sunday Sabbath now became the focus of Christian community and time off. That was the only day for the dreaded amusements of the unwashed. When given power, the Puritans erased the saints' days with solemn, strict, and quiet Sundays. A contemporary writer claimed the Puritans kept the Sabbath so fastidiously that it was almost raised to the level of a sacrament. No Sabbath sports. Sabbath amusements were a dangerous waste of time.
Chain again. Second, keep your voice down. My roommate hates it when I stay out past midnight.
What, are we in middle school? What roommate sets a curfew?
A God-fearing Puritan roommate. And where were you? Going about the devil's business, no doubt.
Who is this guy?
Jedediah Diligence Breckenridge III. And what is your name, you misbegotten spawn of the underworld?
Steve.
Named after pagan deities, no doubt.
No, after my dad, actually.
The dad of lies, no doubt.
Calm down, Jedediah. I'm sorry I'm late, but it's the weekend. Cut me some slack.
Yeah, it was just a party, man.
Aha! A fiendish festivity that included the offspring of the Serpent of Old, no doubt?
Offspring of the Serpent of Old?
It's what he calls women.
With their flaxen hair and tantalizing elbows, they're the very embodiment of sin.
Whoa, why do you have that belt?
It was illegal to profane the Sabbath. Before Cromwell's age, it was said that anyone in England could point out the Puritans by how piously and legalistically they kept the Sabbath. This economic approach to the Sabbath helped industry, but was an upheaval to Christian culture. Sunday became more of a day of recovery from hard work during the week than a day of worship, celebration, and community. Indeed, it became a rest day out of necessity. And with worship services mandated during the Cromwell years, refreshment for the soul and body suffered.
I'll leave a night and day to be your pilgrim.
The separatists believed that each Christian had a calling from God in their everyday occupations and were expected to make a success of it. The biblical parable of God giving a talent was taken literally, and the Puritans expected each other to make 10 talents out of it. They taught that the individual Christian labor is good for the soul, and its fruits were required for the furthering of God's kingdom. Modern historians claim they find little in the Puritan strict Sabbatarianism that was based in the Bible. They created a culture they desired and only later justified it with Bible texts. Again, this is modern historians' assessments. Puritans preached independence from tradition, independence from the Church of England, and especially economic independence. The old adage, "The Lord helps those who help themselves," came straight from the 17th century Calvinist Puritan Algernon Sidney in an article titled Discourses Concerning Government. This philosophy was a twist on the modern prosperity gospel, except you didn't pray for personal wealth. You worked to give it to God and His kingdom. But they took it even further. While medieval Christianity had believed that the wealthy must serve the poor, the saints treated those in need as if they were Christ. The Puritans learned to look down upon the poor as idle. They had brought in the prosperity of capitalism and work. There was no excuse for poverty or want. St. Paul had written that those who didn't work didn't eat. The radical Calvinists made poverty a crime. One might bring to mind Charles Dickens' Scrooge when one thinks of the 17th century Puritan during Cromwell's reign. But not all Puritans. Some Quakers remarked that the Papists were more charitable than the Christians. This Puritan emphasis on working 6 days and being economically independent created a wealthy middle class. And though Puritans believed usury was a heinous offense, without meaning to, the Sabbath Wars greased the wheels of capitalism. The Sabbath played a part in the separatists coming to America, but the 17th century Sabbath Wars took place in Europe and would not enter America for a little while. So we must return to England. Back in England, Christian traditions were being examined. Were Christian practices simply assumed to be from Scripture? What about a state church versus Christian liberty? Some Puritans believed the world was so corrupt that Christians should not have involvement in politics. Calvinists taught that a saved elect were predetermined to purity. The world was lost, therefore all associations with non-Christians must be severed. God was calling them to come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins.
Babylon is fallen, is fallen, is fallen. Babylon is fallen to rise no more. Babylon is fallen, is fallen, is fallen. Babylon is fallen to rise no more.
Their identity was that of the poor, persecuted little flock, until they came to power under Cromwell. 1642 was the beginning of the English Civil War, as well as the peak of the 17th century Sabbath Wars.
I'll leave a night and day to be a pilgrim.
Puritan Oliver Cromwell found himself in power. Quickly, we will explain how all of this relates to the Sabbath. It is necessary to draw the picture of what is happening in England that spurs on the Sabbath Wars. There's another group that plays a part in British Sabbatarianism. A group of Puritans who believed in millenarianism, or that an imminent thousand-year period of the saints ruling the earth would culminate in the Second Coming. It was these eschatology-minded Puritans, the Fifth Monarchists, who made an entrance onto the Sabbath story from 1649 to 1660. Fifth Monarchy men read into the Book of Daniel a present Fifth Monarchy. Adventists will recognize this reference as Nebuchadnezzar's idol of gold, silver, bronze, and clay. This would be the equivalent of Daniel's four kingdoms of Babylon, Greece, Medo-Persia, and then Rome. The Fifth Monarchists added one more kingdom. These British men believed that the fifth kingdom of Daniel's prophecy would establish the kingdom of heaven on earth. The British royalists were part of this political Fifth Monarchy men, but that would not last long. The Fifth Monarchist Manifesto claimed it was their duty to resist any regime that hindered the coming of God's kingdom. They labeled themselves insurrectionist saints. There was no room for religious tolerance. It was up to their little sect to bring in this kingdom so that Christ will be the only potentate and king of kings of all nations. Some played with the thought that the end of the world would be the dreaded numerology of the year 1666. Several of these men not only believed that the death of the king would usher in the kingdom of the saints, they plotted his death. Even though just a few, this justified British military action against the entire Fifth Monarchist group. Then in 1649, King Charles I was captured by his enemies, accused of treason, murder, and tyranny. He was tried, convicted, and beheaded. Most Britons were shocked. Quickly, the Parliament passed a law that the king no longer ruled by divine right and abolished the monarchy. The royalists, made up of clergy, the upper class, and many Puritans who had upheld the crown were now the outsiders. The Puritans and Presbyterians, who had called themselves separatists, seized power. Lieutenant General Oliver Cromwell became the British Commonwealth Lord Protector. 2 days later, with his Puritan zeal, Lord Protector Cromwell abolished the House of Lords. The Fifth Monarchists, a small but forceful part of the new Parliament, were fully convinced that the execution of Charles I in 1649 was a fulfillment of Scripture and marked the end of the Fourth Kingdom. Cromwell, who had been a sympathizer, would later consider them wild revolutionaries and use them as part of the reason he totally disbanded the Parliament in 1653. Cromwell, the Puritan, was now a military dictator. His laws, based on radical Puritanism, were unpopular. The people objected to his heavy taxes, his intolerance of the Church of England, and his moral code, which outlawed dancing, athletic games, and the theater. The Sabbath was strictly enforced. Weaving into history was the contentious views of the Sabbath. There were discussions, debates, conferences, demonstrations for and against, laws and executions, all because of the disagreements on how to interpret Exodus 20, 8 through 11.
I'll leave a night and day to be your pilgrim.
Historians have tried to trace just what caused the Sabbath to become so important to the Puritans that it compelled them to wage a theological war over it. Before the 17th century English Civil Wars, and the church and state positively encouraged recreation and sports after Sabbath prayer on Sunday. The Church of England and the Crown thought it was important for the citizens to relax and have fun. Anglicans believed the holiness of Sunday was based on the church's authority to establish a holy day and based on Christ's resurrection. Up until then, they didn't consider it a Sabbath in the strict theological sense. However, because the Reformation had caused the loss of faith in many, Sundays were spent in worldliness, entertainment, and sports, fairs, and exhibitions. There was dancing, drunkenness, gambling, and blood sports, as in ancient pagan Rome. The Puritans saw this as state-sponsored sacrilege. Now, we know that the Reformers had taught that each Protestant should read Scripture and have themselves as the final authority, making Scripture and their reading of it as the final authority for their lives. With the rise of Puritanism, the Calvin separatists began to blur the distinction between the Old and New Covenant laws. In 1573, Presbyterian Puritans had come to believe that the judicial laws of Moses were binding upon the Christian, and even taught that Christian princes, and I'm quoting here, ought not to the slightest degree depart from them, end quote. But when they read Scripture, they literally linked Sunday with the Sabbath commandment in the Ten Commandments. Christians must go back to strictly keeping the Ten Commandments, especially the fourth commandment about keeping a Sabbath rest, but on Sunday. So
let me get this straight. So they're talking about Sunday, but they're using the term Sabbath rest.
Yes.
For Sunday.
Right. Yeah.
So basically when they talk, they would say Sabbath, but they were really talking about Sunday.
Correct. And we'll discover in a few minutes why, because this is big. Okay. Christians had discovered the fourth commandment before this, and it had not yet erupted into a full-scale theological battle until the Paris event. There was an incident that many historians believe helped spur the intensity of the Sabbath storm. In 1583, during a sporting event at the Paris Gardens on Sunday, as people were watching bears and dogs tear each other apart to the crowd's amusement, the upper gallery collapsed, killing 7 and injuring many. While most people blame it on the age and condition of the structure, Puritans would come to blame it on the wrath of God for Sabbath breaking. Scholars believe this was one of the topics, the secret meeting of Puritan pastors in Dean England. Now we talked about that right in the intro of this. Okay, so.
Or it could have been termites.
Yeah, that's right. Well, that's what they said. It was because it was such
just
disrepair.
Old and disrepair.
Okay. So this spurred on more intensity. Various books and pamphlets about the Sabbath began to emerge right at the turn of the century, the 16th and 17th century. The first sign of Sabbatarianism came from those who believed Sunday was the Christian Sabbath. English Puritan clergymen Richard Greenham and Nicholas Bound, B-O-W-N-D-E, put out books within a few years of each other defending Sunday as Sabbath. Now, they weren't defending it against Seventh-day Sabbatarians. They were defending it against the Church of England, who didn't believe in a Sabbath at all. Okay, so many have believed that the Sabbath Wars actually made such a big impression on Christians that it led to the rise of Puritanism.
Mm-hmm.
So we found out one of the reasons that Puritans went from the Netherlands to the New World was because of how they were keeping the Sabbath. In the Netherlands, they weren't keeping it. So now we find that just the rise of Puritanism itself came around, as part of this whole Sabbath Wars thing. Okay, so the Puritans saw all this corruption on Sunday, and so they said, we need a change, a drastic change. England needed to return to its historic Christianity. Part of putting things right meant a state-protected Sabbath rest. Okay, the Puritans introduced Sunday law. The British Puritans introduced Sabbatarianism into Christian tradition, not Catholics. In fact, the term Sunday has always and had always been the Lord's Day. But now with the Puritanism, British Puritanism, Sunday was now called the Sabbath.
The Catholics were already going to Mass on Saturday anyway forever.
Yeah.
So they didn't ever cross their mind, really.
Right. And so the way people said, you knew that it was a Puritan who was speaking, because they were immediately labeled as a Puritan mm-hmm. when they said, oh, this is the Sabbath on Sunday. Right. Because the Anglicans and the Catholics said the Lord's Day. So anyway, there's a switch that Adventists should be aware of. Puritans were able to convince the church and the state of the importance of Sunday sanctity, and restrictive laws forbade festivals, which had been the lower and middle classes' only opportunity for recreation. And that was taken away. Sabbath breaking became illegal. But Anglicans fought against these new Sabbatarian laws. In 1621, there were more and more Puritans in the Parliament, and they had more money, and so they were making a bigger dent in their influence in Britain at this time. So in 1621, a bill for regulating Sabbath observance progressed unimpeded into the Parliament. In 1622, Bishop John Prideaux, I'm not sure, he leaned towards Puritanism, but he delivered sermons against Judaizing Sunday on Sabbath, or Judaizing a Sunday Sabbath. He was against that. So this is going to get really complicated in just a minute here. Hopefully we'll have enough stuff going on up here. We can make some sense of it. The British Parliament introduced Sabbath regulations on Sunday in 1624 and 25. Some of them became law. Now, it's ironic to note that the Puritans under Cromwell had control over Britain. When they gained control, Sunday laws came into effect, because for decades they had been petitioning the crown for religious liberty. Yet, when they attained power, the Puritans, they didn't extend liberty to the Catholics or Anglicans or even other Protestant sects.
I'll leave a night and day to be a pilgrim.
Now, okay, why was this such a war? What was going on in these people's minds when they read, the fourth commandment, which to Catholics would be the third commandment? Why did it cause so many problems when all these people were reading it? Well, all these little questions came up. The Sabbath created divisions and bitterness. Books, lectures, conferences, even demonstrations for and against the Sabbath sprung up. There was little consensus over what the Bible actually taught. When was the Sabbath? Was it the first day or the seventh day of the week? Had the seventh day always been Saturday? 17th century scholars pointed out that many worldwide calendars placed Sunday as the seventh day of the week, Monday being the first day of the week. There was evidence that Israel kept a lunar calendar, placing Sabbaths at fixed intervals in the month according to the moon, not a continuous seven-day cycle.
Well, that would really mess up your calendar, wouldn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, that's right. So when do we keep the Sabbath? Was it by the moon or by, you know, and had no. this cycle been continuing? See, now Adventists today have looked back and you say, oh, well, it's always been continuous. But we have ways of finding out that they didn't. Remember, you know, this was back in the 17th century. So they didn't have the information we did. So even if you believe that the cycle has never been interrupted, how would they know that? You know what I'm saying? And Anglican bishops pointed out that Christians must not Judaize, that there is Christian liberty. And this is based on St. Paul. They said there are no more holy days. And he said, one day is like the other. Don't judge people on your Sabbaths. So that's what they said. Hey, let's go by the scripture.
Yeah.
And they did not want Christians to fall into the old covenant recidivism. Was keeping a Sabbath day a weakness to the Christian, or was it a blessing? Should we take the Sabbath day rest literally, or was it to be taken like many of the early church as allegorical? Was the Sabbath rest supposed to be a spiritual rest? Was every day now a rest in Christ, because it said every day is alike in scripture? Was the Sabbath a day of rest, or did the commandment demand it also be a day of worship? Did the Sabbath go from evening to evening or from morning to evening? They were actually arguing. We've looked at hundreds of these books. Well, dozens anyway. I don't want to exaggerate, but dozens. And these are the things I got from their arguments. Mm-hmm. This is not supposedly. I got these. All of these are from their arguments. Didn't St. Paul tell us that we're no more holy days? Or does the church have the authority to command a holy day? Even if it wasn't the Sabbath, just a holy day.
Right.
Shouldn't their laws be protected? Shouldn't there be laws protecting the Sabbath? If it's legitimate, there needs to be laws, because that's the way it was in the
mm-hmm.
Bible.
Mm-hmm.
What about legal requirements of citizens to attend worship services on Sabbath? Is public worship necessary, or could a person keep the Sabbath privately in their own home? And what about just the idea of the individual's liberty of conscience? That's what the reformers fought all the time, is for the individual's liberty of conscience. And now the Puritans were coming in and trying to take
right.
that away. But one of the most pressing questions was that if one were required to keep the Jewish weekly Sabbath in the Old Testament, would one then be required to keep the monthly and annual Sabbaths as holy days? Keeping a Sabbath was complicated, and these questions were so controversial that men treated their opponents in very unchristian ways, with tirades and insults and mockery. In fact, contemporaries at this time quipped that the topic of Sabbath had become so contentious that the Sabbath itself had no rest. Okay, so now enters one more layer of complication in all this. The Seventh-day Sabbatarians. We have the Sunday Sabbatarians, now the Seventh-day Sabbatarians. Okay, the guy named John Trask. He was the very first. Lots of scholars disagree with lots of scholars on this. This is Sabbath Wars, so everybody has a different... but we're going to start with him. Okay, so this guy named John Trask, he was a famous Jacobean Judaizer. He was the first English clergyman to preach the Sabbath is the seventh day, and which is Saturday, in opposed to the Sunday Sabbatarians. Because of this, in 1618, he was stripped of his ministry, publicly whipped. Then he had one of his ears nailed to a post in one spot. They pulled it out, went to another post, so that everybody in the city, in a different part of the city, they put another one in his other ear. He was nailed to a post, but he was made to stand at the posts for a while. He wasn't just, they didn't yeah. just do it really fast.
And as we'll find out when I get to a part here in a little bit. They had but something with the ears.
Yeah, there was something right.
They messed with their ears as penalty.
Yeah. Then, as reported by a contemporary of him, after he stood there some convenient time, he was to have his, on his forehead, there was to be a J burnt, the letter J burnt on his forehead. This was to signify that he had been trying to Judaize the people. Among Trask's other teachings, in addition to the Sabbath being Saturday, he taught that Christians must keep all the Old Covenant ceremonial laws. So after Trask, a man named Theophilus Brayburn was the most successful evangelism of Saturday Sabbatarianism before the British Civil War. King Charles I had reissued the Book of Sports. Now, there was his father, I think, had issued it the first time, and he issued it this time, but it was fighting against Sabbatarians. He was saying, no, these are the sports we're going to have on Sundays. He's king. He can make those decisions. So this is the reason they were having these guys in response, these Sabbatarians, and all the Puritans were upset at this. And he didn't like the fact that these Puritans were starting to regulate Sunday. The king allowed for dancing, archery, vaulting, and other sports. The Sunday laws caused persecution of those Saturday Sabbath Sabbatarians who insisted that Sunday be a work day. Remember, they believed that the fourth commandment says, 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. The seventh is the Sabbath. So they believed you had to work on 6 days. So if your Sabbath was on Saturday, that would mean you have to work on Sunday. And so they were protesting this very vehemently.
Because of the work angle.
Yeah. Right. The Sunday had to be for them a work day.
Yeah. Not only did you have to go to meeting house.
Yeah.
You absolutely had to work on all the other days.
Yeah, right. So if Sunday is the wrong Sabbath, then you're supposed to be working on Sunday. That's what that's what they believed. This caused Brayburn to be jailed in 1634 for his teachings. He was released and he avoided controversy, but eventually he would write pamphlets on religious liberty. So he was back to the idea. He went to, oh no, no religious liberty, to, we have to have it. Okay, another prominent Saturday Sabbatarian was Robert Cleaver. And he started preaching, and there was a guy named Robert Sanderson who fought back against Robert Cleaver with a defense of Sunday Sabbath. At this time, the king commissioned the royal historian, Peter Halen. And when you study the Sabbatarian Wars, nobody is more prominent than Peter Halen and a guy named Robert Cox. He would come later, though, and he reported back on this time. But Peter Halen was a contemporary, and he has written a massive amount about this. And his work defends Sunday. So he was commissioned by the king, and so his work defended Sunday, but not as a Sabbath. He said it's a holy day based on the authority of the church. So he was coming from a purely Anglican perspective. Okay, so the Puritans finally got their way. They pushed and they pushed and they pushed. And finally, King Charles was beheaded in 1649. And thus began Oliver Cromwell's rule. We spoke earlier about this, in the narration. The Sabbath Wars continued as James Oakford, in his 1650 book, wrote, "The doctrine of the Fourth Commandment, deformed by popery, reformed and restored to its primitive purity." Now, there had been lots of people that had had anti-Catholic books, but this was the first one that blamed the change of the Sabbath to Sunday on the Pope. Now, this book was not just censored and burned, but Oakford was jailed because of this. In 1651, a man named Dr. Peter Chamberlain, who was a noted physician to the royals, he began observing the Saturday Sabbath. He founded the Seventh-day Church in London. It was the very first Seventh-day Church. Now, they had a scandal because of a Jew. It's a long story, but a person came in claiming to be a Jew, and they made a big deal about it, and they showed that, yes, you know, Sabbath, see, we can get the Jews. See, if we just keep a Sabbath, a Saturday Sabbath, we'll get Jews. Well, anyway, the guy was a liar. He was a false Jew. He never was a Jew. And they discovered this, and so it ended up causing so much scandal in that church that everybody left. It dissipated. But the doctor started another church in another part of London that would become the mother church of the Seventh-day Men, who would then come to America later. The fifth monarchists and the Seventh-day Men would later come to America and start the Seventh-day Baptist church there. Okay, but this guy, Peter Chamberlain, the doctor that started this, it was rumored that he was a fifth monarchist, even though he worked for the king. Now, he did, a lot of the fifth monarchists were Anglicans. They didn't exactly, they believed that the fifth monarchy was going to come in when the king died, but they didn't advocate anything bad against the king. They supported the king. They just believed it's coming soon. Okay, so he was thought to promote the idea, and he did make the claim that the papacy was the little horn that changed Sabbath to Sunday. Okay. In 1653, the English Parliament under Cromwell attempted to model the new assembly on the Jewish Sanhedrin of 70 members. Now, this was promoted by the fifth monarchist, John Rogers. So as you can see, they're taking it, they're pushing, the Puritans are pushing a theocracy on England. In 1650, William Saylor, the second pastor of the Seventh-day Baptist Church that was founded by Dr. Chamberlain, called on the British government to recognize Saturday, not Sunday, as the state Sabbath. Now, among his congregation were several potential problematic men. So, Cromwell died in 1658, and Puritan rule ended. With the return of the monarchy, some of the Saturday Sabbatarians were tired of their role as radicals and disappeared. But the people that stayed became even more radicalized. There was a guy named Christopher Pooley, a notable fifth monarchist, sorry, Henry Jesse, a Seventh-day Man, who published, what the Crown understood as very seditious works. Thomas Tillman published a tract about how to colonize the world with Saturday Sabbatarianism, and he was noted for his debates with a guy named Matthew Coppinger, and a lot of you will recognize, another one he debated with was Quaker George Fox about what day is the Sabbath. Okay, So Thomas Tillman, a guy named, you know, Christopher Pooley, and Edward Skip, and John Fox were considered the most dangerous of the Seventh-day Sabbatarians. The king had allowed religious liberty, but now he had changed his mind. A guy named John James, another apocalyptic Sabbatarian preacher, was taken to jail, and the Solicitor General said of him and these same men that they were going to destroy the monarchy, and by that destroy England. And if you destroy England, you will end up destroying the world. So this was very serious for them. So no more, the king said, enough. In January 1661, London was the scene of a bloody insurrection by the Puritans. The rebels' intention was to depose the recently restored Stuart monarch, Charles II, and replace him with another king. Jesus. They failed. See, they were intending on having an absolute theocracy. So okay.
They're talking about the Jesus, right?
Right. The Lord. Mm-hmm. A bricklayer, John Belcher, also pastored a Baptist church and was a Seventh-day man with fifth monarchist ideas. He and 34 others were arrested as dangerous and seditious persons, thrown in jail, but released within a month. Another group of 26 were arrested. Their leader, Thomas Venner, known as the Venner Rising, where 13 of his people were executed out of the 26, half of them were. They were officially noted to be desperate persons. These rebels believed in an imminent apocalypse. Of course, they were fifth monarchists. Of interest to Adventists was that Venner not only preached a Saturday Sabbatarianism, but he preached to them out of the prophecies of Daniel and Revelation. Sabbatarianism and last day prophecy had attracted each other somehow way before Ellen White's visions. Now, at this execution, this big execution at Tyburn, and that's in England, John James' speech before his execution became a public plea on behalf of the Saturday Sabbatarian movement. That's what he ended up thinking that was worth dying over, and he was beheaded. James was not so much martyred for his beliefs in the Sabbath, even though that was his last plea, but by the perceived menace of these Sabbatarians that were now inextricably linked with the fifth monarchists and other radicals. Dr. Peter Chamberlain, the man who had started this, the first and second Sabbatarian, you know, Seventh-day churches in England, declined to speak in favor of any of these men who were executed, most of whom were members of his own congregation. In 1662...
Makes you question his sincerity.
Yeah, and he was not... After that, he kept a low profile. In 1662, an act of uniformity required all Protestants who consider themselves clergymen to submit to the Church of England. The time of this religious sedition had to stop. This caused a roundup and punishment of a new group of Sabbatarians. In the next 10 years, Saturday Sabbatarians, at least according to the church, the Anglican Church, had a sad tendency of popping back up around London. The Sabbatarians themselves wrote, "Thick clouds and darkness are upon us in many places. We are in jeopardy every hour." In 1671, a meeting of the Fifth Monarchy men and the Seventh-day Sabbatarians was discovered in London, and they were raided and taken to London Tower. Both Baptists and Anabaptists became itinerant preachers preaching the Sabbath even after that. Sabbatarianism was winning, but it was the Puritans who thought Sunday Sabbath that were making international visitors remark that Sunday is nowhere more fastidiously kept than in England.
Babylon is fallen. Babylon is fallen to rise no more. Babylon is fallen. Babylon is fallen to rise no more.